गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी गो टू द फिफ्थ यूनिट ऑफ इलेक्ट्रिकल टेक्नोलॉजी, दैट इज अल्टरनेटर्स और सिंक्रोनस मशीन्स. सिंक्रोनस मशीन मीन्स सिंक्रोनस जनरेटर्स एंड सिंक्रोनस मोटर. सो today's class to discuss about the operating principle of alternator and also construction of alternator. Topic is principle of operation of alternator and construction of alternator. This is the syllabus for 5th unit of electrical technology, that is working principle of an alternator, constructional features of an alternator, armature winding, pitch, comma distribution and winding factors, EMF equation of an alternator, voltage regulation by synchronous impedance method, theory of operation of synchronous motor. That means to know about the how the alternator will be working and where the alternator will be utilized in widely. Next, constructional feature of alternator, then the internal structure of alternator, that is armature winding, pitch and distribution and winding factors, EMF equation of an alternator, voltage regulation. Already we know the voltage regulation definition, so we can discuss voltage regulation for transformer. Now we'll go for the rotating machine, that means here alternator, that is speed regulation, whereas in transformer we discuss about the regulation in terms of voltage regulation, change in terminal voltage, no load voltage to full load voltage, and is expressed as no load voltage. But coming to this one here, the voltage regulation must be calculated in terms of speed. No load voltage to full load voltage, difference between no load speed to full load speed, and expressed as no load speed, or it may be full load speed. And lastly, go for the brief discussion about, that is a theory of operation of synchronous motor. Completely study about the alternator and working principle of motor. So this is the unit syllabus. So now let us go for the topic, first topic, that is introduction. Generally AC generators, or maybe we can also called as alternators, usually you can call as always we can call as alternators, but so basically alternators is nothing but AC generators. So AC generators or alternators operate on the same fundamental principle of electromagnetic induction. There is nothing but DC generators, as DC generators. So that means dynamically induced EMF. Whenever the magnet is, whereas in DC generators, magnets are field is stationary, but armature is rotating. That means armature is rotating, field is stationary. So upper part is field, lower part is armature. So field is stationary, armature is rotating in the DC system, I mean DC generators. Now in this AC generators, we just reverse the these two actions. That means armature is stationary, field is rotating. Field is rotating. Now, when we go for the stationary armature, we have so many advantages. So many advantages. Later slides, we can discuss the advantage of rotating field or stationary armature. Just you can observe the field is outer part and armature is lower part, right? In DC generators, field is stationary, magnet field is nothing but magnets. The field is stationary, armature will be rotating. But in the AC generators, the action of these two parts will be just reverse of it. That means field is rotating, armature is stationary. Why? Because so many advantages there for stationary armature, right? Okay. Next slide, we can discuss the advantage of stationary armature. Now, why we can call it as the generators are synchronous generators or synchronous motors? Synchronous, already discussed about the what is synchronous and what is asynchronous in the fourth unit, that is induction motors. Induction motors are always called as asynchronous motors. Why? Because induction motors are may rotating with less than synchronous speed or more than synchronous speed. Synchronous, less than synchronous speed or more than synchronous, but not at synchronous speed. That's why the induction motors are always rotating with asynchronous speed. Synchronous speed is nothing but 1500 rpm. Induction motor does not rotating with 1500 rpm, always less than the 1500 or above the 1500. Suppose if it is less than 1500, so we can call it as induction motor. Above 1500, we can call it as induction generator. Why? Because slip is, so n minus ns, ns minus n by ns. So ns minus n, n means suppose 1300, that means so positive value. So you suppose n is more than, that is 1600, suppose slip is negative. Where slip is negative, the induction motor will behave as a induction generator, right? But coming to this situation, that means in this unit, the alternator or synchronous motor, that is synchronous generator or synchronous motor, so always rotating with synchronous speed only. And what is the synchronous speed formula already discussed in the third unit? Ns is equal to 120 f by p under all conditions. F is the frequency and p is the number of poles and ns is the synchronous speed of a motor generator. Now, generally, what is the principle of generator? Is nothing but dynamically induced EMF, otherwise Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction, right? So what is meant by electromagnetic induction is nothing but, so it produces an EMF. That EMF falls where it is produced, conductor, right? When an EMF is induced in the conductor, whenever the conductor cuts the magnetic field, EMF is induced in the conductor. In the first unit also, we can discuss at the early stage of this subject, we can discuss about the Faraday's first law, Faraday's second law. What tells about the Faraday's first law? Whenever a conductor cuts the magnetic field, an EMF is induced in the conductor. Basically, what are the requirements? What are the requirements of production of EMF? Magnetic field, conductor, relative motion between these two. Magnetic field, conductor, relative motion between these two with respect to space or with respect to time. So whenever conductor cuts the magnetic field, suppose it is a conductor, so it is a magnetic field flowing from North Pole to South Pole. So whenever conductor cuts, the conductor is rotating like this, right? So rotating like this. So whenever conductor cuts the magnetic field, an EMF induced in the conductor. That is, this tells about the Faraday's first law. And this is also called as Faraday's first law of electromagnetic induction, otherwise law of electromagnetic induction. What's about second law? The EMF is induced in the conductor whenever conductor cuts the magnetic field. How much of EMF is induced in the conductor? That gives the second law of Faraday's. That means the EMF induced in the conductor is directly proportional to the rate of change of flux linkages. So E proportional to d pi by dt. The EMF induced in the conductor is directly proportional to the rate of change of flux linkages, d pi by dt. E proportional to d pi by dt. So this is the generator principle. So look at the figure, north pole, south pole. The flux is flowing from north pole to south pole, and conductor may be arranged like this. So conductor is moving like this. Conductor is moving like this, anti-clockwise direction. So movement is like this. So when conductor is parallel, there is no cutting of flux. There is no cutting of flux. Angle between these two is zero degrees. So there is no cutting of flux is nothing but d pi by dt is zero. D pi by dt is zero is in the sense E proportional to zero. So EMF is zero. So the conductor and magnetic both are in parallel to each other. Otherwise the angle between conductor and magnetic field is 0 degrees. There is no cutting of flux such that the EMF induced in the conductor is zero or minimum. Suppose the conductor is moving like this. Some of the conductor is cutted by the flux lines. That means the EMF induced in the conductor is minimum, somewhat better than the latter one. So that is E proportional to d pi by dt is low. So EMF is low. Suppose exert both are perpendicular to each other. Otherwise the conductor and magnetic field both are orthogonal to each other, such that the conductor may cut the maximum flux. The maximum flux cutted by the conductor. That means d pi by dt is maximum. Therefore EMF induced in the conductor is also maximum. Right? Suppose again it will be like this. The flux cutted by the conductor is minimum and EMF is also minimum compared to 90 degrees. So at exactly opposite to each other. Both are parallel but exactly opposite to each other. That means 180 degrees. This is the 0 degrees and this is 180 degrees. So the EMF is negative, EMF is zero. Again EMF is comes to zero, there is no angle between these two. There is no cutting of flux such that EMF is zero. So look at this half wave, 0 degrees, EMF zero, 90 degrees, EMF is maximum. Again 180 degrees, EMF is zero, like this, a positive half cycle. Again comes to the again comes to the 270 degrees. So like this. Class lo unnadu cheppamma. Again comes to the 270 degrees. They are perpendicular to each other. But in opposite direction. That is nothing but the EMF induced is maximum, but in negative sign, minus EM. Again, it will comes to the same. That is nothing but 360 degrees. Both are parallel to each other. This is equal to 0 degrees. Both are parallel to each other. There is no cutting of flux such that EMF is zero. So first positive half cycle at 0 degrees, EMF zero. 90 degrees. EMF is maximum, positive maximum. 180 degrees, again EMF zero. 270 degrees, negative maximum. 360 degrees, again zero. That means on complete full cycle, the EMF production will be like this in the armature. So this is the motor principle, because so why I'm telling about the generator principle, motor principle, means in this unit generator principle is there and also working principle of motor is also there. What is the motor principle? Whenever a current carrying conductor is placed in a magnetic field, whenever a current carrying conductor is placed in a magnetic field, so it produces some force acting on the conductor. Because of that one, a torque is produced in the conductor. So that may leads to rotate the motor. A current carrying conductor is placed in a magnetic field. Some force acting on the conductor. A twisting moment of the force or turning moment of the force is nothing but about an axis is nothing but torque. That may leads to rotate the motor with some speed. Right? So look at the figure clearly. I am putting a conductor, current carrying conductor is in placed in a magnetic field. So because of that magnetic field, look at the force. Flux lines will be not straight line, it may be curvature. That means some force will acting on the conductor. Because of that force, so there's some torque will be rotated, so torque will produced. The torque will be, the direction of torque will be shown in the figure clearly, and the motor will be rotating. Motor will be rotating. So this is the principle of motor. So now first we go for the principle of operation of AC generator. Already discussed in the last slide. 0 degrees, 90 degrees, 180 degrees, 270 degrees, 360 degrees. In general, electrical machines, that is both AC and DC, works based on the principle of Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction. So Faraday first law, E is equal to BLV sin theta, right? EMF is induced. EMF is induced. So this is nothing but Biot-Savart law. We are already studied in the 10th class. For a particular length of particular, we have to choose the particular length of conductor. Suppose you can consider L length of conductor and velocity V and flux density B. The theta is nothing but angle between those two. So now EMF induced that conductor is nothing but BLV sin theta. So that is the Faraday's first law, EMF induced in the conductor. Whenever a conductor cuts the magnetic field, an EMF is induced in the conductor. The magnitude of EMF is E is equal to BLV sin theta. Now comes to the Faraday's second law, already discussed in the last slide. So EMF induced in the conductor is directly proportional to the rate of change of flux linkages, that is d pi by dt, E proportional to d pi by dt. So E is equal to, you have to eliminate that proportionality, E is equal to minus n d pi by dt. What is tells about this minus? This minus is nothing but Lenz's law. So what is the statement of Lenz's law? I already discussed in the first unit. That means EMF induced in the conductor is always opposite to that of applied voltage. That means that opposition is gives the minus sign. So look at the figure. Synchronous generators are alternators. Synchronous generators are alternators mainly utilized for generating the power in the power stations. Power stations. Generally, idle power stations are there, diesel power stations are there, and thermal power stations are there, or gas power stations are there, and also some special applications also we can utilize these alternators. Two types of alternators or two types of generators will be there. AC generators, cylindrical type of structure and cylindrical type of alternator, and also salient pole type of alternators. So cylindrical type of alternator may be utilized in the steam turbine. That means cylindrical type of alternators we may called also turbo alternators, high speed alternators. The number of poles are very less. NS is equal to 120 F by P. 120 into F means as usual 50 Hz by P. Suppose you can consider P is equal to 2. That means so 120 into 50 by 2, 60 into 50, 3000 RPM. So synchronous speed is 3000 RPM. That means the alternate, the generators with rotating with high speed, the generators are called turbo alternators. That means this type of alternators may be utilized in thermal power plant or gas power plant. Suppose the generators may be rotating with a low speed or medium speed. That type of generator is called salient type of generators. So that type of generator is utilized in hydropower stations. Hydropower station, right? So this is the picture of salient type of generator or alternator. Now we'll go for the starting. Today's class first slide I give the what is the difference between DC generator AC generator means DC generator so field is stationary armature is rotating but coming to the alternator just reverse of it that is field is rotating armature is stationary why you go for this type of structure compared to DC generator is nothing but so many advantages there the advantage of rotating field over a stationary field system otherwise the advantage of stationary armature over a rotating armature what so whatever it may be advantage of rotating field system over a stationary field system first of all it is easy to place armature winding why because armature stationary is nothing but you have to place the conductors in the armature slots easily compared to rotating one next one whenever armature is stationary and slots are stationary that means we have to insulate the winding and also we have to insulate the slot to slot that may be easy to insulate stationary winding for high voltages next one the stationary armature can be directly connected to the load circuit without large number of slip rings and brushes there is no slip rings there is no brushes the three phase winding directly connect to the load here only two slip rings are required for dc supply to the field winding of rotor here we are utilizing dc supply also where the excite we are giving a to excite the rotor we are giving a dc supply so to excite the rotor means you are giving the dc supply to the rotor that means we can called as exciter we are utilizing an exciter that may be starting the alternator right so exciter is nothing but dc generator we are giving the dc supply to the alternator rotor of alternator now go for the important one for this sometimes they asking what is the advantage of rotating field over stationary field sometimes important 5 marks very very important construction in induction motor and generator construction is very very important difference between those two rotors in induction motor squirrel cage and slip ring here cylindrical salient very 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 important difference and very very important construction also very very important as usual in the induction as we discussed in the induction motor construction of induction motor here also two parts is there that is stator and rotor so stator is nothing but a stationary part of an alternator rotor is nothing but rotating part of a alternator now first we go for the stator so it is the stationary part of the machine and it is built up of silicon steel laminations because to reduce the iron losses so this stationary part that is stator consists having a slots on its inner periphery so this is the stator core so inner periphery of the stator we have some slots we are putting some slots that is open type of slots this is the we can call as tooth and these are the slot with an insulating band this is the insulating band around the conductors right this is the stator winding first stator frame stator core stator winding as we discussed in the induction motor right first so three parts as usual stator frame stator core and winding what is the stator frame as usual stator frame is nothing but it is a outer body or outer part of the complete machine so outer body of the machine that may be made up of cast iron or cast steel and it protects the inner part of the machine so cast iron is used for only because it is having high mechanical strength, right? Stator frame is nothing but outer part of the mission that may completely protect the, the complete mission, inner part of the missions, right? And it is made up of cast iron. Why we go for the cast iron is nothing but cast iron having a high mechanical strength, right? So next one, stator core. As usual, core is nothing but made up of silicon steel material. So silicon steel material means automatically reduce the hysteresis losses, and we may insulating to each other is nothing but reducing the, laminating is nothing but you can reduce the eddy current losses totally by using silicon steel and laminations. So you may reduce the iron losses, right? Stator core is made up of silicon steel material, and it is made up number of stampings which are insulated from each other. Stator winding. As usually, stator winding is nothing but made up of copper. Copper. Stator winding is made up of copper material as usual. So now the slots are cut on the inner periphery of the stator core in which three phase or single phase winding is placed. That enameled copper is used as a winding of winding material, enameled copper. Look at the figure once again. So look at the figure. These are the conductors. These are the slots. Slots are so insulated to each other. So, and this is the stator core. Inner periphery of the stator core consists of slots, and under the slots we have to put the conductors. And this is the winding, copper conductor, and this is copper winding. Now go for the rotor. Rotor is a rotating part, and here two types of rotors are available. Salient pole type rotor, as usual, cylindrical pole type rotor. So in this salient pole, first of all we'll discuss about the salient pole. Salient pole or projecting pole, look at the figure. The poles are projecting outer body of the stator, outer body of the rotor. That is nothing but poles are projecting. That's why you can call it as projecting type of alternator, or it may be also called as salient type of alternator. That means the poles are projecting or mounted on a large circular steel frame which is fixed to the shaft of the alternator. So this is the circular steel frame, and poles are fixed outer periphery of the steel frame. So right, and this is the winding is placed, and it is the flux is flowing from north pole to south pole. Here also north pole to south pole, like this, north pole to south pole, and it is connect, one is connected to the shaft, and another is connected to the slip rings, right? These are the DC supply to excite the rotor. We are giving a DC supply to excite the rotor. Coming to the non-salient type pole, so once again, 1 minute. The salient type rotor, it is having a large. So look at the figure. The space is uneven. That means the air gap is uneven. Here small, here high. That means the air gap is uneven. Is nothing but the flux distribution is also uneven. And it is having a small diameter and more axial length, so such that it may be utilized in low speed applications, and EMF induced is also very low value, and harmonics also presented. Coming to the non-salient type, so look at the figure. The slots are this type of rotor is maybe look like as a cylindrical type of rotor, and slots may be, poles may be included the inside of the shaft also, whereas in salient type poles are projected, but here poles are inside of the shaft. That may be, that means the air gap is uniform throughout the rotor. That means, so the flux distribution is uniform and EMF is also induced more. And here having diameter is large, and the axial length is small. And it is made up of a smooth solid forged steel radial cylindrical. It is having a number of slots along their outer periphery. As the slots are put on the outer periphery. Now go for the comparison, very very important. Salient pole type and cylindrical rotor. Salient pole rotor having a large diameter and it is having a small diameter. So salient pole having shorter axial length and it is a long axial length. Poles are projected, no projection, smooth cylindrical type. There is no, some damper winding are provided to fulfill the, our harmonics production is high. So to reduce that harmonics, we are providing a damper winding. There is no need of damper windings. And it is suitable for low speed hydro generators applications. Maybe it may be utilized in hydro power stations. So in cylindrical rotor, it may be suitable for high speed. That's why it may be utilized in thermal power plants. Windage loss is high here. Losses are high, EMF is low. Losses are less, EMF is high here. Right, harmonics are produced, harmonics are less. Like that, we may difference between these two. We differ the, compare the salient pole and cylindrical type of rotors. Very very important construction and this difference. Advantage of rotating field system over the stationary field system is very very important. These three questions are very very important. Thank you. Next class we discuss about the what is pitch, what is pitch way, what is pole pitch, what is pull pitch, what is short pitch, what is chorded pitch, then what is the pitch factor, what is the distribution factor, what is the winding factor, and the derivation of EMF equation. Thank you. To see this video, please subscribe DBS Talks. Thank you once again.